Cool. Okay. Thanks to you for bearing with that. Hello, I am Tim, and it really is great to be speaking here today and also to be speaking before this wonderful community that I'm lucky to be a part of. Today, I want to look at three broad things. I want to look at Ruby in the present and how we got here. I want to look at Ruby from a different perspective and also see what we can do to build Ruby's future. So let's start by talking about Ruby in the present moment and about our community. Here in Australia, we have come a long way. We're at our fifth straight Ruby conference, and it's the biggest ever. And another really amazing fact is that we've just had our 20th Rails Camp, which is an event that collectively we've run together for 10 years straight now. This is a stunning achievement and really a credit to everyone who's here. And Ruby itself has come a long way too. It's over 21 years old now. And I thought we could take a quick look at how we got here. So to get started, we need to go back to the 90s. To 1995 in particular. So there we were, working on our 33 megahertz machines with one screaming single core, writing some HTML 2.0, working from some CGI bin directories, and oh, well, that looks interesting. This thing called Ruby just had its first release. Then some 6 years later, 2001, we all put a new book on our shelves, one with this pickaxe on the cover. Now, programming Ruby, it counted for a lot in the history of Ruby. It showed the world that Ruby was really worth paying attention to. And then Rails happened, and that world, well, it changed forever. Version 1 came out in 2005, and we're all making blogs in 15 minutes, and then one thing led to another, and then here we are, 12 years later, in 2017, with so much to celebrate. Ruby, well, it's gone from strength to strength. It's running our text editors, and it's running our phones. It is everywhere. Jobs are trending up and to the right, and they show no sign of turning back. And Rails? Well, it's scaled. In the hearts and minds of web developers everywhere, whales don't represent website downtime. They're just the majestic sea creatures that they are. And those Rails camps that we hold, well, people are still going to them to write Rails. Friends, we've truly made it. No, this is not quite our present anyway. Instead, I think Ruby faces a number of challenges. The first is competition. Now, 1995 was a remarkable year for programming languages. We saw the first releases of Java, JavaScript, PHP, and Ruby, all of these things still in widespread use today. But since then, we all know the computing world has changed. Moore's Law, we saw it level out, and well, Ruby fell on the wrong side of it. It's a multi-core world today, and Ruby doesn't really have a strong story on parallel programming. But we're seeing now a lot of other languages that do. You know, take Elixir, for example. I'm sure you all know more than a handful of our Ruby friends here who will work with Elixir and Phoenix whenever they get the chance now. And that's not the end of it. In the last decade, we've seen functional programming become useful for more everyday tasks. Languages like Clojure and Scala help us model our data and our systems in practical and robust ways. And just like Elixir, they open up new possibilities for concurrency in our apps. Then we have the compiled languages too, Rust and Go. These things might have been originally penned as systems languages, but they're seeing much wider use than that, not the least of which because people want their code to run reliably and fast. And of course, we have JavaScript. Our friend JavaScript is not only on the server now, but it's literally everywhere. And the thread that ties all of this together is that building for the web is such a common thing that all these languages and their communities have an interesting story to tell about it. Whereas over here in Ruby, well, I think we've been telling the same story for quite a long time. We've settled into this comfortable groove around Rails. And I have great respect for the Rails project and the team, and we have much to thank them for. And it's still a very compelling platform for many people today. But I think the truth is that as a result of Rails' wild success, it's come to dominate Ruby through no fault of its own. But in many ways, it's become our opiate. It dulls any widespread effort in our Ruby community to push our app architecture in new directions. Well, we've also seen Ruby make a transition as our language and as our community matures. Many of our pioneers have left. These people who led the way in the beginning and laid the foundations for our ecosystem, well, they've moved on to other communities and other projects. Many of our friends have left, and given how social software is, this is no small thing. And we've reached the point where we can actually be comfortable but also complacent. That busy, heady period of the early adoption phase, well, it's long gone. Our foundations have been laid. And we've reached this time when a lot of people, and more than ever before, are just quietly getting their work done with these largely settled tools. And DHH calls this reaching the late majority. And in a way, it's a deserved place. And it's come off the back of decades of toil. And what do we have to show for this? Well, we have a lot of mature tools, so many things. We have Rails, of course. We have Bundler and RubyGems underpinning our entire ecosystem. Rack, RSpec, Capybara, SQL, the list goes on. And many of these things have gone on to serve as inspiration for similar tools and other platforms, which really is a credit to Ruby. We have a healthy culture too, just like Liam and Mel were talking about. Rubyists are practical developers. We have a real focus on getting things done. And of course, we have a real focus on testing as part of our practice. I've learned so much about testing and about TDD through my time as a Rubyist. We also have this focus on making our tools a joy to use. This programmer happiness ideal is not a given. It's part of our DNA as Rubyists. And we also work to make our culture ever more inclusive. We care more about just the technology, but also about its broader social consequences. So these things, they have real value. There's so much that's good in our community, and these are things that are worth preserving. Now, you might ask then, is anything really at risk? It's true, yes, we're now in this crowded world with all these other language options, but we're already onto a good thing with Ruby, right? Do we need to change anything? I think we actually do, because our community is really its people, and we need to keep our people engaged. And we need to do this because open source communities are non-exclusive. People's attention will always be spread. And prior achievements only really do count for so much. Matt sees this too. He's put it this way. Open source communities are like sharks. They need to keep moving forward. So we should reconsider Ruby in this light. Look at all those other things that are capturing people's attention and see how we stack up against them. And we should ask ourselves if we're still offering enticing, innovative, and productive ways to build software for the modern web and beyond. So at this point, we might pause to reflect upon Ruby itself and ask, how do we stack up against all those modern languages when we have our design constraints for Ruby still anchored in that 90s single core world? And how can we catch up to those other languages when it's a stated goal of Matt's and the Ruby core team to evolve our language only slowly? I think firstly, we can be grateful for that, because a stream of steady improvements and strong compatibility from release to release is a good thing, because it keeps our community together and using the latest that Ruby has to offer. We won't have to face any schism around major language readjustments in our future, which is a thing that, a real problem that plagues other languages. And it means that when the big improvements do come, things like Ruby 3's promised concurrency and typing features, well, adoption should be more straightforward and we can all move forward together. But we don't need to wait for this, because Ruby is ours. It's an open ecosystem, and our contributions count. This is a good thing. It was that contribution of Rails in the early days that brought Ruby that explosion in popularity and then set up everything else that followed. And yes, we do reap the benefits of this famously friendly, pliable language at our core, but it's what we've built around it that makes it attractive to so many people. And it's this pliability of Ruby that's given us room to explore how different modes of productivity might look. And this kind of exploration has led to real shifts in how Ruby is used over time. Ruby's idiom can change, and it has changed. We had the early days, that Wild West moment back in the beginning when people were coming from all different backgrounds and just figuring things out. And, well, apps back then took many forms, and many of them wouldn't resemble the kind of Ruby we expect to see today. And that's because after Rails came along, our idiom really crystallized around Rails' own style and design emphases. And then, as we had more experience and our apps grew up, we sought even greater consistency. So we hopped onto the idea of shared, common style, documented through things like the Ruby Style Guide and enforced by tools like RubyConf. But now I think we're starting to see another shift in this timeline as ideas from other languages and ecosystems start to be explored in Ruby. And this results in code that takes yet another kind of form. We're starting to see a different kind of Ruby. And this is what I'd like to share with you today. I'd like to introduce you to DryRB. It's an organization of gems founded in late 2015. And we call them next generation gems because they're informed by our experience in working with Ruby to build for the web and for over many years. And they're our attempt to nudge the idiom a little, to offer a new and better way to build your apps in Ruby. Now, myself, I've been working with the DryRB core team every day for the last year and a half or so, building out these gems, as well as using them to ship real working apps. And the reason I want to share this with you today is because I think it holds a few keys as to how we can build a better future for Ruby. So, that's been a lot of talk, but this is a programming conference, right? And I know I love talking through some code, so let's talk through some code. Let's just shift our minds a bit, and we'll take a look at DryRB. So one important thing to know first is that DryRB approaches Ruby from a slightly different perspective. We follow a hybrid of functional and object-oriented programming. So if we think about functional programming, what are a few things from that world that can help our Ruby apps? Well, firstly, I think if we want to orient our app around functions, we need to treat those as values so we can combine them to build larger systems. Our app becomes simpler to work with if we favor immutability wherever possible, avoiding any sort of internal mutable state in our objects. And also, we want to avoid external side effects as much as possible so that most of our code can run in any kind of context. And together, these things help us better understand the flow of data through any part of our app. And we can satisfy all of these criteria by building functional objects in Ruby. Let's take a look at one now. Here's the simplest functional object. It has a call method, just like Ruby's own procs and lambdas. And that call method accepts an input and returns an output. That's it. Doesn't mutate the object's state, and it shouldn't mutate the input data. And unlike classical objects in this way, functional objects actually make a clear separation between data and behavior. The only data they hold in their state are things like other objects acting as collaborators or static configuration. This is state that will never need to change. And we set that via the constructor only, if we can, just like we do here with this repo object. And in fact, this is an example of constructor dependency injection, which is the classical object-oriented design technique that works to great effect here with our functional objects. So the end result is that we can initialize one of these objects just once and then go on to use it many times over. And then regardless of how or when these things get constructed, they can go on to become a collaborator for others. So now we've come to grips with that technique. We can put DryRB to use and build something. Let's build our own blog in 15 minutes here in 2017. And we're going to look in doing this at both reading and writing articles to our blog, and we'll do it step by step. And hopefully this will give you some sense for the design possibilities, both in the small and in the large for systems like this. Now, we are going to work through a lot of gems here, and together they form our application stack, such that it is, but it's not a one-size-fits-all situation like we've come to expect in many cases. So this is why I'll introduce the gems one by one, because yes, while they do work great together, they're only ever loosely assembled, so you can swap things in and out as you need. So let's get started with a GET request so we can get our list of articles. We need to tackle four things here. The routing and HTTP for that incoming request. We need to take care of object dependency management. We need to render some views and also model the data that we pass to our views. So the first thing in handling this HTTP request, we'll use a gem called DryWebRouter. This actually brings together two gems. DryWeb, which is the high-level organizing umbrella around our application, and also Router, which is the flexible routing toolkit from Jeremy Evans. So to get started, we can install this gem and then run a command to generate a new project for our blog. And as you'd expect, it creates a structured project directory for you, and then we'll jump right in here to a routes file. And this is the part of the app that's powered by Router. Router lets us organize our routes into a tree of nested blocks. And in larger apps, this can make for some really concise logic, because we can set up some context in outer blocks, and that remains available for all the blocks that are nested within it. But in our simple situation, we just need a GET route for our articles. And then inside of it, we'll render the list of articles. And this view method in our routes, it's actually loading and calling a view controller object for us. And this is taken care of by the Dry System gem. Dry System sits at the heart of any Dry web app. And it's a high-level organizing system for our app's objects. And it uses a simple naming convention to make these objects available from a central container. So what does this actually mean? Well, it means when we call r.view with articles index in our routes, this becomes a fetch from our container using this identifier. And that returns to us a pre-built view controller object, which we can go to work with right away. and that object was loaded from a matching source file automatically. And that's all been taken care of for us by some very basic language level features. Drive system relies on good old require and load path, which means this loading technique is deterministic, really easy to understand, and really easy to put to work on for us. So after all of this, we've got a view controller object. And this part is powered by DriveView, which is a gem that combines functional view controller objects with templates to render our HTML. So here's how it looks to start with. And we just need to configure this view controller to tell it the template to work with. So if we look at this right now, that's certainly not enough to fetch something from our database and render a list of articles. This is actually the job of a dependency. And here we reach the other critical part of an app built around dry system, and that's dry auto inject. And this is a nice way for a class to declare its own dependencies and have them resolved automatically for us from our application's container. So we can go back to our view controller, and then we can set up a dependency. So here we're including this import mixin, and we're saying we want a repository for our articles. This object will act as our interface to the database. So we can use it here to expose an article's listing to our view. Now, we want this listing to contain rich entities for our view to work with. And we can build these with dry types and dry struct. Dry types offers a system of data types and coercions for us to use in Ruby. And it gives us stricter typing in the places that we care about it the most. And one of these places that we care is when we're modeling our application's entities. So here we have an article, which is a dry struct. And we want this entity to contain only a certain kind of attributes. And we want those attributes to only contain a certain kind of data. Dry struct ensures that these objects get initialized only with 100% valid data. So it means that when we go to work with them, we can work with them with 100% confidence about their contents. So it means much less second guessing in places like our views. And unlike active record models, we don't mutate these structs. They're simple value objects. So they're simple to pass around our app, and we don't have to worry about accidental mutation or side effects along the way. So knowing all of this, we can make our template, call our view controller back in the routes, and we get the output that we want, our list of articles. And if we look back at that routing shortcut again, and remember that it's just a shortcut for a call on our view controller object, which has been fetched from the container, we now have the basis for completely standalone view rendering. So we can use the same mechanic, not just for our web pages, but for many things across our app, things like emails or anything else that's disconnected from a normal HTTP cycle. So in the end, we can come all the way back up to our routes, and our job's done. We've got our list of articles. What do we do here again? Well, Dry Web Router took care of routing and HTTP for us. Dry System and Dry Auto Inject managed our dependencies. Dry View rendered our view, and we used Dry Types and Dry Struct to model our data. Let's go to the other side now. Let's post an article. Two extra things we need to cover here. Validation of input data, as well as success and error handling. So we can go back to our routes and add a new handler for our post request. And inside this, we can resolve another object from our container. And what we're getting here is a create article functional command object. And then once we've got it, we can call it with the form post parameters. And just like before, this object's been made available to us by dry system. So from our resolve helper in the routes, it becomes a fetch from our container. We get back a pre-built instance ready to work with, and that was loaded automatically from its corresponding source file. So let's take a look at that file. Here it is. It's just a regular functional object. And to start with, we're going to validate some input data. And we'll use Dry Validation for this. It's a powerful standalone validation library, and it helps us model our validations with precision and work with any kind of data. And it's based around schemas. So, and this is the place where we define our validation requirements. So in this case, let's say we expect a title and say we want it to be at least three characters long. We want a body and a publish flag. Now, those previous two keys, they were strings. But in this case here, we're setting a type expectation. We want this to be a Boolean. And the same for published at. We want it to be a time object. So now this schema is built. We can take our form post data, send it through the schema, and then out the other side, we can see that Dry Validation has made some really helpful data coercions for us. And it does this courtesy of Dry Types, which it uses under the hood. So if we look back at that form post, we have stringy keys and stringy values. Then out this other side, we get symbolized keys and values coerced into their appropriate Ruby types. We have a real true value there and a real time object. So the form schema in this way acts as a really important boundary in our system. It handles all the baggage of HTTP, then out the other side, it lets the core objects of our app work with properly structured and properly typed data. We also get friendly error messages, just like you'd expect, as well as hints about certain checks that couldn't be run yet if the types weren't satisfied. So the user gets all the information they need to correct their errors in one pass. So now, with that in mind, we can go back into our command and check for successful validation. And then when it succeeds, we can save this new article into our database. And to do this, we inject this same repository as a dependency, and we can call create on it with our validator to save the article. Now, this is just the successful path, though. We also want to handle failure. This is where monads come in. Another concept from functional, do you think I'd hit you with monads in the first talk of the day? Here we are, 2017. It's another concept from functional programming, and we put it to good use here for modeling success and failure. And to do this, we use the dry monads and dry matcher gems. So we can go back to our core method for this operation and start to give it some meaningful, workable output for both these cases. So we can start by wrapping our successful result in a right object and our failure result in a left object. Now, these are both instances of the either monad. But in practice here, it just gives us a return object that we can work with consistently in either of these cases. And it goes on to enable things like some nice, flexible result matching, courtesy of Dry Matcher. And this fits really well into our rotor routes. So before, we just had this single call to create. But now we want to handle these different outcomes. So we can pass a block to get our matcher and start by handling the success case. So here, when the article's posted, we'll redirect back to the list so we can see it. And then we can handle failure. And we do this in exactly the same way. We just match onto that case. And here, we re-render the form with the validation object passed to it so the user can see some error messages. And this technique elevates failure handling so it becomes a first-class concern across our app. We can handle failure in exactly the same way as our success case. And in fact, this matcher won't even run unless we have all these cases covered. So we have truly robust result handling. A note here in these routes is that this is the only place we've dealt with HTTP today. So these routes act as another really important boundary in our app, because our app's core objects can just be concerned with doing their own jobs and return success or failure as appropriate, and then let those results be handled elsewhere in a way that makes sense. And here in our routes, we do some HTTP things with those results. So that's it. We've posted our article. And dry validation helped us take care of validation, and dry monads and matcher took care of the result handling. So that's a tiny little slice of an app built with DryRB. And it might not look like the Ruby that you're used to. We've seen a lot of gems working together in concert, with the integration of those gems happening at a level that's much closer to the surface of our app, rather than tucked away deep into some framework. We have the responsibility of our app broken up over a lot of small classes. And many of those are modeled around verbs rather than nouns. And of course, we have these containers serving as the organizers and vendors of our app's objects, and this auto-injection technique to make these objects readily available to each other. If this has felt a little unusual to you, or even a little uncomfortable to you, well, it's all been for a reason. It's been so that we can make change easier for ourselves. We all know that getting version one of our app out the door, well, that's only just the beginning. The real challenge is in growing and maintaining it from there. So let's take a look at one example of how we might need to change this little blog that we built. Let's say we need to add a new feature. We want to send an email notification to subscribers when an article is posted. Now, there are various ways you might handle a change like this, some better than others. We'd all be familiar with callbacks or adding conditional logic throughout our code. But instead, I think we have a truly elegant option at our disposal now. We can use dry transaction to model this change. And we can do this because we've already laid some really important groundwork here. We have our container of functional objects, with each of those objects returning right or left for success or failure. And this is everything that we need to start to compose them in some interesting ways, like we do with dry transaction to model this behavior as a business transaction. So for our transaction, we can define a sequence of functional objects, which get called one after the other. And the output of each one becomes the input of the next. And this sequence continues as long as each step succeeds. And this is the perfect arrangement to satisfy this new change. We can create a new standalone notify subscribers operation, run it after create article, and then outside of this one transaction, these things aren't coupled in any way. So we can go on and reuse them as we need throughout the rest of our app. Dry transaction also gives us an enhanced result matching API. We can handle success just like before, but we can also look into failures from specific steps and handle each one of them as we need. This is a really powerful feature, and it's all been made possible by the design of this app. So that's one example of change. And as you might have noticed, all of it involved adding new code. So all of our existing code could be left untouched and continue to serve us reliably. But when we do need to go back and make some modifications to existing code, we can do that with confidence, because much more of our app can be tested in true unit test style, in complete isolation. Because we're using dependency injection, we can have dependencies passed in as doubles in our tests and focus on the code under test in each case. And this is useful for database-backed apps because you can avoid the database for many of your tests, and you don't need to do things like globally stub out database calls just to get the data you want. And the end result is better, faster tests, and more confidence in our work. What's made all this possible? Well, it's been that we've made simplicity a driving focus. And we apply it at every level, from the gems that we choose to use, to the individual objects that make up the behavior of our app, all the way up to the broad systems that we use to organize our app. And it really boils down to prioritizing a clear separation of concerns at every point, and also looking for a clear flow of data from place to place. And we've also taken note to design around really critical boundaries in our app, and built around them appropriately. So all of our HTTP handling, well, that happens in one place in our routes. Our validation schemas act as another boundary. They take input data from external sources and give it to us in properly typed and properly structured arrangements. And all of our database persistent logic, well, that happens in its own layer as well. Now, I've glossed over persistence, mostly because we're going to be treated to an excellent talk on RomRB later today. But I can at least say now, this fits perfectly with the kind of app we've been building here. It separates commands and queries. It allows for explicit modeling of data. It ensures that we write an API to suit our own app's data requirements and then nothing else. And then after we've done all of this, it lets us put all of this behind these repository objects, which act as the sole interface between the core of our app and its persistence layer. And in putting these external systems behind clearly defined boundaries, it means we can preserve the core of our app to focus on its main tasks, on its own domain. We're not building just a web app. We're building a Ruby app first for a specific purpose, and then we go on to offer a web interface around it. And in building for our domain first, we've also chosen tools to serve our app, rather than contorting our app to fit the requirements of some external tool. Now, none of these ideas in isolation are new. You probably knew this from the first look, especially when you look outside of Ruby. Dependency inversion and inversion of control containers, well, you see them a lot in the C# and Java worlds. Monads and pattern matching, well, they come from any number of functional programming languages. Dry system is heavily influenced by a similar library for closure, and you would have recognized many similarities between ROM and Elixir's Ecto as well. But what we've done here is take these helpful approaches, which are common elsewhere, but not in Ruby, and found a way for them to be consistently and naturally applied across an entire Ruby code base. This is a new kind of Ruby. And the result of all of this, of our focus on simplicity, on our domain, on proper boundaries, on small components working in concert, we created an app that's easy to change. We created a change-positive architecture. And given how much of our job it is to manage change, this is a crucial advantage that we can create for ourselves by following some of these approaches that we've looked at today. A change-positive app is more maintainable. We can easily understand it at any point and adjust it as required. A change-positive app is sustainable. We can work on it just as easily at day 1,000 as we do at day one. And all of this makes a change-positive app truly joyful to work on. So that's my pitch, anyway. What does it look like? You might be asking this. What's it look like if you go ahead and jump in and do this? Well, I can at least talk about IceLab. This is where I work. We're a team of 16 people. Half of us write Ruby every day, and the other half are involved in our apps through design and front-end development work. And the DryRB story and the RomRB story, these things were compelling enough that over a year ago already, we adopted these as our primary web stack. And for each of us, working with these apps has been really a revelation. Personally, I felt I've made a real level up in my skills as a software developer. It feels like I can finally and consistently apply those object-oriented design principles, things like Solid. I can't tell you how bad it felt before to live in this awkward reality where I had this gap between what I was doing and what I wanted to do, and I couldn't find my way across that gap because I had tools that made it awkward or impractical to go from one place to the other. And yes, I can look Sandy Metz in the eye again. And in building these apps with the Dryobi gems, we've learned how to better design our own gems. We're more intentionally designing APIs, we're thinking about flexible, general purpose usage first, and then integration second. And we've also learned to recognize and avoid some of the anti-patterns that have held us back in the past. And the net result is that I think we've all become better developers and a better executing team. And this is not just for our long-time Rubyists either. We've had juniors join us at IceLab and quickly become productive with Dryobi. And it's also meant that we've been able to start shipping without guilt. Yes, we build software under commercial pressure, just like any other business out there. And before, our tools, well, they allowed us to make bad shortcuts in the name of expedience. And we'd never get the chance to go and rectify these later. But now we have tools that encourage better behavior from start to finish, and we ship things that feel 100% solid with code that we're really happy to maintain. This is a wonderful feeling. We've been in Ruby development for a long time, and working with Dryobi has shown us that we don't need to leave. It's our future Ruby. Now, I think ICEB's approach might be an attractive pathway for any similar small or mature Ruby team, for the team that wants to continue to design the best engineered applications. For this, you don't need to go and look elsewhere or try some emerging technology purely because it seems to facilitate certain design patterns better. Instead, you can continue to stay with Ruby and leverage your existing deep knowledge of the entire ecosystem. And you can use that to build better architected web apps. But what if you've grown up beyond this? Say you did start small at one point and worked a lot with Ruby, but now you're all grown up as a business. You've got your squads and your microservices and your diverse technology mix that seems to inevitably come with this. Well, I think if that diversification was for things like better architecture, performance, correctness, type safety, things that you thought you couldn't easily do with Ruby, then maybe some of these approaches from today might give you reason to keep your Ruby around a little bit longer, or maybe even use it in more places than you're accounting for. As Dan McKinley puts it, let's say every company, well, they get 3 innovation tokens, and you can spend them however you want, but that supply is fixed, at least for a very long time. You only have so much innovation in you, and you're better off spending it on your company's core mission, not just the technology that sits underneath to deliver it. Adding technology comes with a cost. Yes, something new or different might make sense in the limited context of a single app or a single team, but if you multiply that across your entire organization, you start to develop inefficiencies. You lose out on the ability to optimize globally. So by sticking with some technology that you're familiar with, that you're proficient with, your company should be able to deliver faster and more reliably. And by doing this with Ruby, you get to stick with an ecosystem that's had decades of work put into it. So these future possibilities, they're not just for highly evolved Ruby organizations either. I think they're for learners too, at all points in their pathway. We all know that Ruby is a fantastic learning language. It's light and expressive, and it lets us go into forays into many different paradigms. And we're also spoilt with a wealth of high-quality learning material already and many fantastic teachers who've chosen Ruby as their medium of expression. So I think when it comes to using Ruby to build web apps, we now have an alternative that is still approachable, but offers many more opportunities for teaching fundamental concepts that will serve a programmer long into his or her career. And this direction for Ruby, well, it's one that many people outside in our community are already taking. We've seen a big wave of interest in Dryobi, and the gems are finding their way into production apps, including some really large ones. And we've also seen some really crucial collaborations start to happen across projects in our community. Take Hanami, for instance. It's a modern, integrated, batteries-included web framework for Ruby. They've chosen to use dry validation for their validation layer, and ROM has also become the foundation for their persistence layer. Adopting these things has allowed Hanami to offer better features and become significantly more capable. And it's also freed up the team building Hanami to spend more of their time focusing on the development experience that they want to offer to their users. And this has actually brought a lot of extra attention back onto those dry IB projects. It's improved their stability, fixed some bugs, and really fleshed out their features. So this is a virtuous cycle, and we're just at the beginning. And that's not all. We can look at Trailblazer 2. It offers a high-level architecture for web apps, and it's designed to work with Rails, but also Hanami and many other web frontends. Trailblazer also uses dry validation for their form models, and in their big 2.0 release, which is already out the door, they've adopted a real functional Ruby approach too. So it fully supports things like auto-injection and apps built around containers like dry system apps. So I think if you want to make good web apps with Ruby, you have plenty of options, and they're better now than ever before, and they're improving every day. So if we go back to our original thought about how Ruby can remain a compelling option in today's much more crowded market, I think it's through an approach like this, where we have a diverse range of competing offerings. This is what will drive innovation in our community and offer it life for years to come. But it does fall on us to make this happen. As I said before, Ruby is ours, so the job to improve its future, that's ours too. And there are a few things that I think can help with this. I think we need to be more curious. Firstly, for trying out some of these unusual approaches that you see in Ruby, like some of today's code included. These things might just help you, and the cost of trying them is really low. And of course, we shouldn't be insular. We should look further afield whenever we can at other languages or other frameworks and the techniques that they bring to the table, because we might likely find inspiration for what we can bring back home. I think we should be more critical of ourselves too. We should look for weaknesses in our tools, for gaps that we can fill, and we should try and make those things better. Yes, Ruby is over 20 years old now, and we have many popular and well-established gems, but it doesn't mean anything's done. It doesn't mean we can't improve these things further or offer a new take. And I hope the one-year-old dry IB project can offer as an example of this. Of course, we should be smart about our work. We should cooperate when we can. Open source software, it takes time, so we should spend that time wisely. We want healthy competition, but not tribalism. So if there's something out there that you can already build upon or incorporate into your own work, then that's a win for everyone, just like we've seen with dry IB and Hanami and Trailblazer. And what helps with this is building our things with interoperability in mind, so that anyone can use your code regardless of how their app or how their libraries are put together. So I think we should try to build something useful and standalone first. That's our code at its most pure, at its most interoperable. And then only after that should we think about building integrations with various frameworks or other niceties around your core. And finally, we should remember to celebrate the joy that we do experience in using Ruby. This is our day-to-day language for many of us, and it remains so for a reason. And we should make this known whenever we can. We're in this happy position where we don't need to compete for mindshare around the new and the shiny, but rather around real, subtler innovations that improve our everyday lives as developers. And when we find these things, we should celebrate them and we should share them. It's through blog posts, talks, meetups, and word of mouth that we grow our community. So let's just count those things one more time. We need more curiosity for the new things in our own ecosystem, as well as the developments outside of it. We need a willingness to find our faults and address them. And we should do this work with a spirit of cooperation that pervades even the code that we write, so it can go on to enable the work of others. And more ta-da emojis, more celebration. This is Ruby. We love this stuff. And when we actively participate in all of these things, we reinvest in Ruby itself. We do our part in ensuring it has a vital, vibrant future. Because after all, there was something that brought all of us to Ruby in the first place, and to conferences like this one. It mightn't be any one particular technical thing. It might be something deeper, something more visceral. As we say here, it's about the vibe of the thing. It's about that programmer happiness thing. It's about that thing that enables modes of thought and design and expression like no other language out there. It's this little quirk of the 90s that somehow made it into all of our lives today. And it's something that can have a bright, multifaceted future. And that's something we can build together. Thank you very much.